resolution of the Gulf model. Okay? And now I want to proceed to the study of Jenkins theories in higher dimensions. There are many preparatory things I'd like to do to set up the study. Okay? Part of the complication of dealing with Yangmer's theory analytically, for instance, in the looped calculations of the Yangmer's theory, as we've described, is that gauge invariance is a pain. Okay, we need to fix gauge invariance in order to do a calculation. Okay? And there is a formulation. It's very important to deal with. It's very important to deal with gauge invariance exactly, even when you're regulating the theory. For the following reason. That, you see, as we tried to emphasize when we, right at the beginning of the course, when we looked at a path integral and tried to quantize it. Okay? If you took a Lagrangian like d mu, a mu, squared, and try to set up Hilbert space associated with that, you would run into trouble. Because A0 would give you states that either have energy unbounded from below or non-unitary, or there would be some, if you try to fix up one problem, another would arise. Okay? So we got around this problem by working with the gauge invariant action. Right? The action for F mu neural being squared. Now, suppose we introduce a regulation scheme that breaks gauge invariance. Okay. Then renormalization group flow, if you start with some bare action with some term that's by some small amount breaks gauge invariance. Okay? Now gauge invariance is not there any problem. Renormalization group flow could, in principle, generate all kinds of operators, including operators like this one, when you come down to low energies. And you could end up defining a theory, in fact you generically will end up defining a theory, that has problems, that has sickness, problem. Right? So, it's very important when dealing with gauge theories and when dealing with their renormalization, to deal with gauge invariance exactly. Okay? And we're going to start moving towards understanding how to do that. Okay? Now, there are basically two different ways. One way that is used in most analytic pen and paper calculations is the way by fixing gauge invariance, like we discussed by Pathipova. And then noticing that the gauge fixed action has a larger symmetry, so-called BRST symmetry. And adjusting your renormalization, working out, this symmetry is automatically preserved by any renormalization group flows that helps you to understand various things. This is one of the things we're going to try to understand. Okay, we're going to try to, by the end of next week, we will have computed the beta function for Yangmer's theory in four dimensions, for instance. But there's some machinery we want to set up for doing that. But there is another way of dealing with this problem, of dealing with the regulation of Yangmer's theories, which is very much used in numerical calculation. And is also useful for various conceptual ways of thinking of the theory. That's called lattice gauge theory. So I just wanted to tell you a little bit about lattice gauge theory today, and to do a few little calculations with that, just to get you used to the theory. Okay, let's start with the abelian theory. So the abelian theory is defined by the action is equal to F mu nu. Okay. Let's put it 1 over 4 g squared. And in my sign conventions, I have, I will need a minus. Okay. Now, remember, of course, that this theory fields it, which is a mu, and an invariance under a mu goes to a mu plus Okay? Now, what we're going to try to do is to do something quite interesting. What we're going to try to do is to make space-time discrete. Okay? So, we're going to try to make space-time discrete, but to do this in a way so that we preserve a discrete version of this game. Okay? Now, the way we're going to work is the following. Suppose we've got some lattice. I'm drawing it in two dimensions, but it could be any dimension. Okay? So this lattice discretizes space time. Points of this lattice are labeled labeled points in space. So let's imagine that it's a cubic lattice of size little a. Now, these A mu fields in the problem, are vector fields. Okay? So they're little arrows. Okay? So they naturally live on links that go between points in space. Okay? Of course, you can put the little arrow in any direction, but once you know basis for a particular vector, you know the vector. Okay? So this is A1, this is A2, this is A3, and so on. Okay. So what we would stupidly have done is to just introduce an A mu field that lives between here and here and associated with here. This is a slightly clever version of that thing. And that is to work instead with the object phi, which lives on a link. So these links are labeled by N. Okay? Which should be thought of as approximately e to the power. So let's say this phi is labeled by two points. It's a link, so it's labeled by x and x plus n a. N is one direction vector, it's either the x hat, y hat, or z hat. Okay? A is the size of the direction in which we're going. And this we will think of as approximately e to the power I a of x times a. That a was a dx, basically. Now, what do I mean by this is approximately that? What I'm going to do is to try to work out what the gauge transformation property. What the gauge transformation property of this object is. Okay? And when you remember, you should think of A as being very small. It's a regular. Okay? So under gauge transformations, we know that A goes to A plus dv lambda. So let's write this in terms of a finite gauge transformation. Okay? So A goes to A plus, so suppose I define a unitary, a matrix e to the power I lambda. Some phase. So if you have a charge field, the charge field of charge n would transform like e to the power I n lambda of x. Okay? So this object, which is going to be not only necessary to be promoted to a unitary matrix, we call it a matrix, let's call it a. U of x. Okay? And this is the gauge transformation property. A goes to A plus d mu lambda. It will be written equivalently as U inverse d mu. Maybe I need an Okay? Now, how does this phi transform on the gauge transformations?
So what was the motivation for defining phi like this?
So is it from the Bloch's theorem which we do like while doing the chronic pairing model in solid state? Like is the motivation?
Motivation for what?
For writing 5 years into the
problem. Hang on, give me 2 minutes, let's see the result, then you'll see the motivation. Okay, hang on for 1 minute. Okay, so now let's look at how phi transforms under the gauge transformation. Okay, so under the gauge transformation, phi prime is equal to phi times e to the power I del mu lambda a, simply because a goes to a plus del mu lambda. Now this, to first order a, I can write as is equal to u inverse of x phi. This is, remember, x plus n a. U of x plus n. Okay, let me change my gauge transform just to make it more standard. Let me change my gauge transformation to a goes to this, or a mu goes to a mu minus a mu. Yeah. Then this will become u. Okay, this was the motivation. The motivation is that it has this nice transformation under this u. Okay,
phi's are scalar fields.
Phi's are scalar fields that live on each link. They're not fields, but they live on links. Yeah, that's just something. It's okay. Now, hang on. If you hang on 2 minutes, you'll see where this is going. Okay, so now we have this nice object, and we're going to use this observation that e to the power I a x, ax times a, to lowest order in a has this gauge transformation property to form the basis for our discretization of the gauge theory. That is, what our discrete theory will be defined by is a theory whose basic variables are phi's, which are postulated, for which we will write down an action, which will explicitly maintain this gauge invariance. So for our discretized theory, this gauge invariance will not be approximate, as it was in the continuum, because it gets corrections at higher orders than a squared, but inexact. Okay? In the limit a goes to infinity, so this will be the discrete version of the gauge invariance that we will preserve while discretizing our problem. Okay? So we will have a theory which will only be able to generate gauge invariant operators under renormalization of flow. Because as an exact theory preserves gauge invariance, albeit of this discrete variant. Okay? And that is a discrete, that we will engineer to be a discretization of the model we wish to study.
But
there's
an issue of taking a flow of a lattice, right? I mean,
that's an issue.
It's very different from taking a flow of a continuum.
Yeah. So actually, what we were, you know, when we do work with the lattice, we never really take RG flows.
Okay.
We will just define the theory, thinking of this as a bare Lagrangian. Okay. Imagining that there is some way of doing the RG flow, you know, using the same framework that we built up for the previous thing. But you see, when we discussed how to define quantum field theories, okay, what we discussed was that all we had to do was to take a particular limit of a bare action. Okay, so as some correlators were held fixed in the other. That we can do on the lattice, and that's going to give us a definition of the theory, even though it will be hard to control, as you say, the explicit RG flow equations. Okay, so we will not actually be writing down RG flow equations.
The A's over here are the objects which live on the points, whereas phi's are the ones which actually live on the links, right?
Wait, nothing lives on points. A's, mu's, also conceptually live on these links. But now, when we go to the discrete theory, we don't have mu's anymore. We only have phi's. So in the continuum theory, we have mu's, which were vectors, so they were always little arrows.
Yes.
In the discrete theories, we've got a scalar field per link. So those are also little angles. The value of the gain of the vector field on that link. Okay? Except that we're not taking the value of the vector field itself exponentially. So maybe I haven't answered your question.
No, that's fine. I'm just trying to understand. So, what looks like to me is that the phis are objects which are actually depending on the two points.
Good.
So, are these local? That's what I'm.
Well, these 2 points are very small separate.
Okay.
Yeah. You know, locality is a question of whether the interaction between this and this go a finite distance away. Hang on for a minute. We will engineer an action so that it reduces in an appropriate limit to have medium. You'll see.
Sorry, I have another.
Yes, go on.
What is the problem if we actually have used A's instead of defining these phis?
You see, A's have this gauge invariance. Okay? That involves derivatives.
Yeah.
Okay? Now, if you try to preserve. Basically, what you want to do is to preserve gauge invariance, not in an approximate way, but in an exact way. Okay? It's just that this object has a very nice transformation property that links you to. Okay. So see, once we discretize that theory, as you said, there are points and there are links. All our fields live on links, but there's something that lives on points. What are those something? Those are gauge transformations. Gauge transformations are associated not with the direction but with a point. It's U of X. The point about this phi object is that now because we've discretized, we don't have U of X's in the middle. We only have U of X's at these points. And the point of this phi object is that it transforms nicely under the remaining discrete gauge transformation. Okay? In some exact way. Okay, good. Now, you see, so now we've got a new set of variables. We've got these phis labeled by beginning in n phis. And we've got this gauge invariance U of X that lives on each set. We want to build some sort of action that preserves the gauge invariance. Okay, so look, suppose we had a phi of x1, and suppose we put a variable which I just denote by this phi is just the phi that goes from here to here. How does it transform? It transforms as u, u inverse. U here and u inverse here are totally unrelated fields. How are we going to make a gauge invariant? You see, if you think about it, you see there's only one way. That is by making products of phi. Such that these products form some closure. Okay? So that this phi, the universe of this phi, will be cancelled by the U of this phi. And so on. So the expressions that we write down in our action, okay, will have to be products of phis over some loop. Okay? Products of phis over some loop, that will be gauge invariant. Any polynomials of these products of phis over some loop, so any function of products of phis over some loop, will constitute a gauge invariant action for this discretized problem. Okay, now we have two options here. We could discretize either only space, or you could discretize space and time. At the moment, I'm imagining a Euclidean would be discretizing space and time. I'll very soon move over to the discussion of discretizing only space. So I'm sometimes going to handle doing in that sketch. Okay, but let's work on this one. Okay, good. Now, let me look at the following. Let me look at what we get. Okay, when we take the simplest little bit. Okay, let me look at what we get when we take the simplest little plaquette. There are these. Oh, by the way, associated with each x and x plus a, we have this phi. But of course, you could ask, there's another way of going down the Grams link. That's x plus a to x. You could ask, what is phi over x plus a to x? It sounds too much like two variables living on a link. And, basically, if you define phi of x, x plus a, you can include a minus of phi, will require x plus na. No, so, minus inverse. Remember the phi, this object, was just a phase. Okay, so W was a phase. And I will sometimes think of W as e to the phi.
So, does your minus a?
No. Just, if we have this phase, it will be the other way. You know, the minus, the negative phase.
Okay, the inverse is just...
inverse of e to the power I a is e to the power minus a. Okay? So this will be the statement that that once we define this thing, phi of x plus an is equal to minus of phi of x plus an, where phi is w is e to the power. Is this clear? Fine. Now what I want to do is to just evaluate this object. Assuming that w was e to the power I ax dx. So the approximation we have, right, roughly speaking, you should think of this pi x plus an as approximately a in the n hat direction. And then,
the w is phi are not the same.
No, w is exponential. I'll write that.
W is the exponent of phi,
and
phi is the exponent of a.
No, W was the exponent of a, and was the exponent of phi. Phi is this.
Oh,
okay. So now what we can do is to evaluate what we get for this little plaquette loop, this little basic guy, in which you go, let's say, the one direction, two direction, one reverse one direction, reverse two. Okay, so what is this? This is exponential of I times. So it's exponential of I times, and now when we go the one direction, this was this phi object, which was basically a1. And let's say that this was at, we start this loop at x, so this is x1, x2. This is x1 plus a, x2, x1 plus a, x2 plus a, and this is x2 plus, x1, x2 plus a. Okay, so this is a1 at x2. And from x1 to x1 plus a. Let's just leave it by the beginning point. A1 always moves in the x1 plus a. Okay? Now, we get something from here, but before that, let's look at this guy. This guy is the reverse. This is minus a1, but at x2 plus a. And also x2. Because this is reverse of this angle. Okay, minus this. you will get. Plus, this whole thing will be multiplied by the length. So we will get plus, this is A2 at x1 plus A, x2 minus A2 at x1, x2. Okay? So if we make the approximation that phi is equal to A times little a, then this basic little plaquette just evaluates to the sum.
So shouldn't that be A2 to x1 plus A, x2 plus A?
What?
The third term, A2, shouldn't it be x1 plus A, x2 plus A? Because it's like...
No, we are labeling A2s by where they start. We are labeling the A's by the starting point of it. Is this clear?
So for the value of the phi one, it looks like that it should be like the other way around.
Yeah, exactly.
What should be the other way around? Let's look at each of these. A1, this A1 here was labeled by x2, x. I should have said x1, x2, you say? I'm sorry. X1, x2. X1, x2. So it's labeled by the starting point, x1, x2. This guy is labeled by the starting point. So it should be labeled by this. We'll be using the fact that it's minus of this. So it's minus of this starting point. This starting point is x2 plus a and x1. Okay? Similarly, this guy here is a2, which starts here. So it's x1 plus a, x2, minus of this guy. It should be labeled by this, but because it's minus of this, it's labeled by this, which is x1, x2. Is this clear? Okay.
So what is the difference between A1 and A2?
A1 and A2?
Are these two different functions?
Yeah, they're two different functions. This is, you know, we've got a vector field. So it's A mu, right? So A1 and A2 are completely unrelated functions. Completely distinct.
So the A's are like the wave vectors, like when we like, for example, a plane wave solution into the ikx. So the A's are analogous to the k's, right?
See, there's no wave functions or anything here. This is just parameterization of the variables of the problem. Hang on. Okay? Now, in the limit that this guy, that the little a is small, we can approximate this by the first term in the Taylor series. Okay? So this guy here is del 2, so this object is approximately e to the power I, okay? Del minus del 2, minus del 2 a1. Okay? And this guy here is approximately e to the power I plus del 1 a2. And then the whole thing is multiplied by a square. So it's already an a here. And this is the a to the derivative. Okay? So, if you look at... so this little bracket is approximately e to the power minus I f12, where f12 is equal to del 1 a2 times del 2 a1. Thanks.
So what is this quantity you are talking about?
Well,
what do you want to do?
The product of these four phi's. The product of these four w's. So this W times this W times this W times this W. Why? Because you see, I'm going to build my action from products of W's over plaquettes, over parts. Those are the most general gauge invariant action. Now I want to understand what this action that I get will reduce to in the continuum. Okay? So this is a preparatory exercise for that. I'm taking the simplest little product, that is a product over an elementary bracket, and seeing what that reduces to in the continuum. So what has it reduced to? It's reduced to the exponential of the field strength times the area. So basically the integral of the field strength over the little area labeled by the plaquette. Okay? What's going on here is of course very obvious. What you're seeing here is a discrete version of, is Stokes' law. Because this thing was e to the power I a dot x. Okay? And Stokes' theorem tells us that a dot x is equal to f. F integrated. So that's what we're seeing. Okay? Now, the thing I'm going to try to do is to build a plaquette action that approximately in the little a goes to 0 limit, okay, reduces to f minus 1. Okay? So, how do I do that? Well, let's look at this object. So suppose I take this object, e to the power I f 1 2 a squared, plus e to the power minus I f 1 2 a squared. Okay? Minus 2. Okay? What does this become to lowest order in the Taylor expansion? Okay? So to lowest order in the Taylor expansion, this becomes 1 plus I times this plus the square. Now the 1 and the 1 from here cancel the 2. The linear terms cancel between these two. But the quadratic terms don't. They add up. Okay? So this becomes I squared and F12 squared times A squared A to the 4. The half of the Taylor expansion cancels the fact that there are two of these. Okay? Okay, so now we're slowly getting into business. Okay, we're slowly getting into business. So now suppose I take the following action. I take the action that is this plaquette. What do I mean by that? That means the product of these four terms. Plus the inverse plaquette. Okay, that's the product of these four W's, but that's just a minus of this. The inverse of this. So that's this guy. Okay, minus 2. Okay, and then sum of this over all the plaquettes of the basic plaquettes of the problem. Do you see that that will approximate minus F mu nu squared A squared.
The internal we cancel.
What internal we cancel?
This internal. If you sum up all those brackets, it seems like ending up with the boundary.
No. There's nothing left. See, we just have this little packet. This little packet is giving us F12 squared. Now you sum a little other little packet. We're only summing basic packets. That will give us F13 squared. You sum another plaquette, the other plaquette will give us F23 squared. So that will give you this F mu nu and F.
So this is because you have chosen to define this as
A1, this
is
like, so
Google's other
directions
probably
to be
something as A3 and A1.
Exactly. Exactly. A1 is just the log of this W. A1 is just this phi of this factor of A in the one direction. In the other direction, it will be A3. However many dimensions you have. Okay? Can you see then that if you do the sum over all plaquettes, including all orientations, you simply get this F, minus F mu squared. Is this clear?
It'll be
8 to 4. Sorry? 8 to 4. 8 to 4. Thank you. And actually, this is probably f mu nu squared by 2, because f mu nu squared has f1 2 squared and f2 1 squared. They're the same thing if we just write. Is this clear? No, no, all basic little things. So let me be clear. I'm not going to sum over anything but a basic square in it. So let me suppose this is my axis. Suppose for a moment that it was two-dimensional. Just because it's the easiest to draw. Then I will be doing the sum over this spaghetti and 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 this spaghetti. Only the basic square brackets.
So what the individual sum is
similar? What? F12 here. But then the full action is integral of F1. Suppose we have two dimensions. The full action is integral of F12 squared. So we need to get F12 squared at each point. Okay? That's why summing over all the points generates an integral. Now if we have a three dimensional, it would be a cubic lattice. And we would have three kinds of plaquettes to sum over. We have these plaquettes, then these plaquettes, and these plaquettes. That will give us f12 squared, f13 squared, and f23 squared. But that's what we need for action.
So building a function in this way will also depend on geometry of this
lattice. Geometry of our lattice? Yes, yes. It's true that we would have to think how that we were using not a cubic lattice. But that's the question. Okay?
Simplicity is the only reason why you're choosing a cubic lattice.
Simplicity. You see, what we are interested in is a discretization of the continuum. Again, we're not that interested in the model by itself, except in the fact that it's a discretization of the continuum. So, of course, when you discretize something, you can always find complicated ways to do the discretization. But you look, as you said, for the simpler.
Sir, are there any associated boundary conditions? If we consider a finite lattice, it isn't true that the ends will be full plaquettes, right? I mean, like, it might be partial plaquettes.
It's a good point. It's a good point. So, this is, of course, so if you have boundary conditions, so the way that it's normally done is to choose a torus.
Okay, so periodic.
Periodics. Everything periodic. Yeah? And then there's no issue. Okay, that's very well suited to dealing with a cubic lattice. Okay, now if you actually end somewhere, then you have to specify what happens to the gauge transformations at these endpoints. Okay, that becomes a complicated issue. It's an interesting physics issue. Let's imagine for the moment that's a torus. Good question. Other question.
A was carrying some x index also, right? So this means
which A? This A mu.
Yeah, A mu.
Yes. So that's right.
So in the final result, will there be some sum over F?
Yes, mu? This is the sum over all plaquettes.
Yes.
So in two dimensions, this is an orientation sum as well as a location sum. So in two dimensions, for instance, where there's no orientation sum, it's this plaquette, plus this plaquette, plus this plaquette, and so on. That's the x index.
So that sum goes over to even f mu nu squared a 4 upon 2. Is there a
sum? So this sum goes over to the a to the 4 was the volume
factor.
Okay, you're right. I will have to put the right right power of A. Thank you. So what we've got, so this thing here would really have had A to the power D. We have A to the 4, so we will have to, this divided by A to the power D minus will be the and this of course is reflective of the fact that the angles coupling in 4 dimensions is dimensionless, but the angles coupling in every higher dimension carries a dimension. Okay, so that's okay. So now let's say it's space, say more concretely,
that's dx.
What?
D.
Wait, boundary is a complicated issue. Like, I would assume just if there are three links on the boundary, you just put gate transmission on just the three links.
No, it's a question of what, whether you're going to sum up a gate transformation. Suppose we end our lattice here. Here's an ending point of the lattice. It's a question of whether you're going to impose gauge invariance over these points or not.
Easy to.
See, in a normal, it's going to be the question of whether you impose a Gauss law here or not. Forget about the discretization. Suppose we're going to continue. Okay, we'll continue theory with some opinion. Basically, what you need is boundary conditions in the actions. Basically, say, suppose you have a classical action. You take any classical action and you end it at some boundary. Just even as a classical problem, that's an ill-posed problem unless you have boundary conditions. Okay? So to define this problem as well, you will need some sort of boundary conditions. Okay? So, the question of what your boundary conditions are will go into the definition of your theory. That's why it's complicated, and that's some choices involved. Okay?
Sir,
yeah.
In the transformation property of point,
yes.
Gauge group from left and right doesn't have to be similar. It can be different, as alternatively different.
Meaning the gauge matrix is different, actually. This U of X is not the same as U of X plus A. But it's, of course, an element of the same algebra.
I'm saying it can be different algebras. Say, one will be one group, some other group. Alternatively, still it will be independent.
Ha! It could be, it could be that.
A bigger symmetry.
That's an interesting question. The way we think of that, is as a bifundamental, if we did that, so the kind of thing that you're thinking of is that there are two kinds of lattice sites, right? Okay, you could have this. You could have a lattice like this, right? Such that on a cross there is one gauge symmetry, on a dot there is another. Okay, so now this whole thing can be thought of as follows. You can think of this whole thing as a lattice. What you would have here, I'm just wondering whether this would be basically a theory with the two. No, but then you've got these gauge fields that are going between the two. What is this thing? Interesting. Like some sort of gauge theory that has basic vector fields associated with not the adjoint of a particular group, but a fundamental of one group can apply, an anti-fundamental of the other.
Yes.
Yeah, but since you are taking square, here it's possible. If you take some other structure, then it will be possible.
Yeah.
Lattice point, there
will
be two kinds of transfer
of space.
I mean,
that's what he's saying. He's saying that the two gauge groups, basically. And when he says that both gauge groups don't live at each point, as a lattice model, it makes sense. The question is whether it approximates in the continuum, some interesting continuum. It's an interesting, let me think about this. That's an interesting question. Okay, fine. Now, so what was our net conclusion? Our net conclusion was following. Our net conclusion was that the action, so the action which was 1 by 4 g squared, d dx, f mu nu squared, let's say that we're working, everything's Euclidean. So these things can be written as sum over plaquettes. One by 4 g squared. And then 2a to the power d minus 1. So, a to the power d minus 4 by 2g squared, p plus p inverse, did I miss a minus sign? It was this. Yeah, this is the sign, right? So, 2 minus. Okay, so let's go, 2 minus p inverse. Okay? And then sum over all brackets. Where p represents the product of these, and all basic options. Is this clear? And so, the Euclidean angle is positive. In this case, so far just U1. Okay? So far just U1. The Euclidean angles are the path integral can be rewritten as z is equal to product over every link. So x and n hat d phi x and n hat. Okay? Exponential of minus a to the power d minus 4 by g squared 2 minus p inverse by 2 sum over all the brackets. My action should be. Okay, yeah, now it moved to Euclidean space.
Okay, right.
Okay, so as to not. Yeah. This is the right sign because you see, this is a positive definite. Okay? This is now a very beautiful formula because it's very concrete. Okay? What we've got is the integral over a phase. This integral for each of these guys runs from 0 to 2 pi. It's a phase at each link. Okay? And then there is a concrete associated action associated with, built up of these spaces. Okay? There's a concrete associated action built under each of these phases, and that object gives us a path integral. Notice that g squared, as we mentioned before, g squared in d dimensions has dimensions of what? Well, d length, suppose we're counting length dimensions, d plus, minus 4 minus g squared, the length dimensions of g squared, is equal to 0. And g squared, so g squared has length dimension 4 minus b. Messed up. Sorry. Firstly, did I get the length dimension right? Let me just put it. So it's g squared f mu nu d dx. So if I count length dimensions, this is okay, right? So it's d minus 4 minus the length squared, the length dimension of g. I just wrote this wrong. So g squared has length dimension d minus 4, and then everything's okay. No, the action that goes in the exponential is always a dimensionless. Okay, here we had a 1 by g squared, which carried some dimension. Okay, in the continuum theory, the dimensions of the integral eat up the dimension. There is no integral anymore, right? These are all numbers, phases, no dimensions. So the dimension has to come out explicitly, and we've seen that. Is this clear? Okay. So this is a numerically useful discretization of the angle's path integral. As you can see, this is very useful to put on a computer. Okay?
While we were writing this 2 minus p minus b inverse, then we drop the higher order terms which drop out only in the continuum element. But will they have an effect if when we keep them in the discrete version of it?
Right. So what we need to do is to look at this action in the limit a goes to 0. Okay. In that limit, they shouldn't have any effect. It's like discretizing a derivative. Okay. Now, of course, you could ask, what does it mean from the point of view? So you're saying, effectively, then there is this coupling. There's this coupling here, which has, which is whatever your Yang-Mills coupling was, your Bayer Yang-Mills coupling was, times a to the power d minus 4. Okay? Now, this combination, if you remember, was a kind of thing we usually kept fixed in our discussion of RG flows. You remember what we did was to imagine that there was some Bayer theory at some scale, lambda naught. We imagined that all parameters in the Bayer theory had dimensionless numbers of order 1. Okay? So, okay, so this combination is very, very natural. Okay, now the fact that this a is going to infinity, is going to zero, what does it mean? It means that we should be calculating correlation functions in very large numbers of lattice units, because the size of the lattice is a, and we are interested in physics at some fixed scale. So taking a to zero is basically the same thing as working in the limit, where you're calculating correlators on very large number of lattice units. You've got a lattice whose size is a. You want to do some calculation with the continuum, let's say its size at distance 1 meter. Take a to 0, the number of lattice units between 1 meter is 1 by a, and so it goes to infinity. Is that clear? Okay. Fine. Now, let me first say, let me first just tell you, I'm not going to go through the algebra, but just tell you that there is a non-abelian generalization of this statement. Okay? Which actually is very similar to this. Okay? So, in the abelian theory we had this W variable. Okay? In the abelian theory, we have this W variable per link. In the abelian theory, W was just a phase, unit norm complex number. So it was in the exponential of a phase. So we parameterize things in terms of the phase. The non-abelian theory, it's not convenient at that. So we continue to work with the W's themselves. Okay? So what are the W's in the non-abelian theory? The W's were exponentials of I times A's. So they were unitary matrices. Because exponentials of the algebra elements give you little unitary matrices. A group elements. Okay? So what we have in the non-abelian theory is a group element. Okay? At every link. Okay? We also have gauge transformations which are group elements at each point. How does the gauge transformation act on the group element that goes from x to x, x plus a? It acts as u of x, u inverse of x plus a. Exactly as it did when we looked at it in terms of w's. That's why I introduced that w. Okay, exactly as it did when we looked at it in terms of w's for the abelian. Okay? Once again, if we take products of links that close, okay? Once again, if we take products of links that close, okay? So suppose I take a product of a link that closes like this. Now, at the moment, this is a gauge element. Okay? It's let me do it the way I've done before, so that's U, this U, test this U, test this U, test this U. How will it transform under gauge transformations? It will transform like U of X, if I begin and end at X, times whatever this plaquette is, times U inverse of X. Is this clear? Because everything in the middle cancels. This is not by itself gauge invariant. But it will be if we take the trace. Because the trace has the property that we take the universe. This side, the new times universe is 1, goes away. Okay? So, once again, so the non-abelian theory has a very similar lattice discretization. Okay? The non-abelian theory is a very similar lattice discretization, and it's given simply by the following formula: product of x and hat. Now, this is du x x plus n hat of the hat. A product over the integrals over the unitary group for each link. Exponential of minus a to the power of b minus 4 by g squared into trace of 2 minus 3 minus b minus. Okay? This formula works almost without modification. This formula works almost without modification, yes?
You said u's are the ones which are living at the points, but...
No. Now there are two different u's. There are the u's that live at gauge transformations.
Which are the ones which are...
Which live at limit points.
Yes.
But there are the u's that are replacing the w's.
Yeah, okay. But these are different u's.
These are different u's. These u's are the variables of the action. The earlier U's you talked about were U's of, I should have called these V's. Okay, let me call these V's.
Yeah.
Okay? These V's are the variables that enter the path index. The U's we were talking about are parameterizations of the symmetries of the action. Okay? So this action here has invariance under V goes to U of X, V U inverse of X plus A n hat. So U's parameterize the symmetries of the action. V's are the variables of the action.
So the sum over equations is
sum.
So in this, in lattice field theories, you don't have to worry about gauge fixing at all.
Ah, that's a great thing. Exactly right.
And so where does all this business about gauge fixing and uniquely specifying one point on each gauge orbit go in this?
These you didn't have to. You see, what we were doing was, you see, if you remember what we did for gauge fixing, is that we said that the original path integral was correct, except that it was infinity. Because for every configuration, there's an infinite number of configurations that contribute the same action. Now, the factor of infinity gave us trouble if we were actually trying to do calculations. But since we only cared about the path integral up to overall normalization, if you could regulate that infinity somehow, then you just don't have to gauge this. Let's see how we've regulated the infinity. Where did that infinity come from? That infinity came from the fact that this, it was the infinite volume of the group of gauge transformations. Why was the volume of the group of gauge transformations infinite? For the simple mundane reason that the number of space-time points was infinite. Because at each space-time point, what is this type of gauge transformations? It's the space of unitary matrices. Set of unitary matrices is a finite dimension, finite volume. Yeah, integrate with R measures, space of unitary matrices. Okay? If you just regulate the number of space-time points, then the full volume of the gauge group is finite dimension. That's what we've done here. So, what we are going to get by this thing is differs from what you would get by the gauge fixing procedure by a factor of the volume of this space of unitary matrices times the number of space-time points in your to the power number of space-time points in your lattice. But if we only care about path integrals up to overall normalization, we don't care. Okay? So, if you think about our Fadil-Popov procedure, the starting point was that this is the path integral we wanted to compute, divided by some overall number. And then we process that.
So the volume of the gauge group is finite.
Is finite.
Because it's a compact group.
Because it's a compact group.
But,
and?
But this infinity is arising because the
number of space time points was infinite. Okay? And here it's just everything is finite. So, you see, we're never going to get an infinity in doing an integral. Okay? That was the problem. The problem was that when we actually tried to do in the continuum limit. For instance, our propagator was 1 over 0. Okay? We were getting infinities and we had to regulate those infinities. And that basically was what we were doing with this finite. But here, because we made the number of space-time points finite, there's no infinity, so we don't have to bother with all that nonsense. It's a great thing. Yeah? It's a great thing to be able to think of the gauge theory without having to think of ghosts and so on, even in your mind. Because that's all totally inessential. But it's needed for calculations. You'll see when we actually compute the beta function of Yang-Zill's theory, what a pain it is to keep track of all these things. On the other hand, there actually is a lattice way of computing this beta function, which we won't discuss in class, but it's up. I mean, it gets rid of all those pains. Okay? But on the other hand, you know, there are some things that are much better to do with pen and paper rather than, you know, in continuum, momentum, dimensional regularization. So you should be able to think both ways. You should not be committed to one or the other. Yeah. Okay, excellent. Any questions or comments about this formulation? What? U and B belong to the same. Yes. Both are U and B. The case that we were studying. Any questions or comments? Okay, excellent.
Is it a natural reason to get
SUN
instead of
UN
when you're looking at it like this?
No, the only reason. Oh, I see. No, there isn't. Yeah, it's in this way of looking at it, the SUN and UN are not trivially equivalent. It's not. There's no factorization. Another way of saying that is that even the UN problem, if you think of this as an exact lattice model, is not a free problem. Again, this is quite a complicated problem. Okay, the problem we're going to study. Okay.
In a non-abelian case, can we write it as simply as like in abelian case, like we wrote phi of x plus a is minus of phi of x plus x. In the non-abelian case, this is
huh.
P, right? It's a matrix.
The way to think of it is in terms of what was that relationship for W's? For W, you see, there's no analog of phi, but there is an analog of W. So the analog for W was W of x plus a is W of x plus a x inverse. That's that same thing.
So V of x plus an is equal to V inverse of x plus an, right?
You should always think of this in terms of group element. Group element inverses make a lot of sense.
So
V
transform
there
in the adjoint?
Which?
V.
V is a unitary matrix. And the transforms in the adjoint, that's this thing. Yes. It's in the adjoint. I mean, yeah, this is the statement. This is a discrete version of the statement that
P.
Yeah, this is the precise statement. We normally talk about, when we say something transforms the adjoint, we normally talk about the infinitesimal things. This is the finite guy. So the statement is that it transforms the adjoint, not precisely precise. But this statement is completely precise and contains all the information.
Sorry, but in the abelian case, the minus was essential in giving me the curl. So how do I get it out? Do I say that V inverse is a minus A?
It's the same thing. Because you see, in the abelian thing also, if we worked in W's, the transformation was WX equal to WX plus A
inverse.
X inverse without a minus.
Yes, but the phi would get a minus, which from which I could get a del 2A minus del 1.
Yes. So, but once again, the way you would show that you get the right thing is to say that approximately these u of x's are e to the power I a ax dx. Okay? So then this inverse thing will become minus 9.
And then
it's the same thing, except you have to be, the only thing that's different is you have to be careful of taking things through each other. Okay? Because it's not a meaning. So when we look at this plaquette, the one bit of algebra I've not shown you is this. That when you take this plaquette plus its inverse, that you get f mu nu squared and take the trace. That, and then you approximate the plaquette as e to the power I, each link as e to the power I a mu times a. The only thing I've not shown you is that when you carefully discretize that, you get the non-abelian f squared trace. Okay. This again is an exercise for you. It's obvious that it's to work. Because whatever you get has to be gauge invariant. Because you started with something gauge invariant. Whatever you get has to have the right limit. That's U1. What else could it be? Okay. But to actually do it is a bit of a pain. Okay. So, now there are two or three things that I wanted to. So far we just dealt with formalism. Okay. It's nice to have this formalism, but it's even nicer to have physics. So, what we can now do is to study these lattice gauge theories in a particular limit in which they're very easy to study. And this limit is called the Stroganov limit. Okay? So, let me. I'm going to do this study. I'm going to do the study first for the U1 theory, and then we generalize it for the P1 theory. Okay. Okay. So I just write this action once again. This number, and what we're going to try to do is to see what we can say about this model as a function of this path integral as a function of g of x. Okay? Now, when can this guy accurately reduce to the continuum theorem? Okay? As you can see, when it accurately reduces to the theory we're studying, you see, all of these guys here were exponentials of phases. In order to get the continuum limit, we needed that the phases, I'm going to say one inaccurate thing here, we'll correct that next class. But we needed that the phases were not very large. The inaccurate thing is that what we actually need is that the phases are not very large modulo 2 pi. And this is an important thing which we'll come to. It's a very, very important thing. We're taking only 0 to pi. So then, that's right. So within 0 to 2 pi, it's fine. Okay. Yes. But you will see something that can wind. You'll hang on. Yeah. If that's true, that's not something we can impose by hand because we're doing a path integral. So dynamics should impose that. When will dynamics impose this? You see, when this phase is very near to zero, 2 minus this is near to zero. So deviations of the phase are, you know, the action. So the action contributions that where this p deviates significantly from phase, from unity, are suppressed by 1 over gr squared. So if gr squared is very small, that will tend to suppress contributions in which this phase goes all over the place, and we'll try to keep it near phase equals, near the complex number 1. Okay? So the continuum limit of this model, can reasonably be expected to be achieved only when this gr is a small enough. Okay? And that, especially for the non-abelian theory, it's a very difficult problem. It's a problem solving non-abelian. However, there is an opposite limit, in which just mathematically this model is easy. That opposite limit is when gr squared is very, very large. In this limit, the coefficient of the action is small. Okay? So gr squared is large, and let's say 1 over gr squared. Squared, we call it 1. Just to remind us of that. Okay? So then, in this limit, what we've got is product over x and n hat, 0 to 2y, dy x n hat, exponential of minus epsilon sigma 2 minus b inverse by 2. Okay? Now, in this limit, these quantities here are not at all forced to be near unity. Okay? He was very far from the continuum, isn't it? But it's a very easy limit in which to study the problem. Okay. So, why is this easy? Because in this limit, we can effectively just Taylor expand in epsilon. Okay? And I want to do a small little calculation. Okay? To compute some quantity in this into leading order in epsilon. Okay? What is the quantity I want to calculate? The quantity I want to calculate is the expectation value of obesity. What do I mean by that? I've got on my lattice gauge theory, I make a closed path that is not one of these basic small closed paths. Some arbitrary closed path. Okay? But I make it closed. So this observable is a gauge invariant observable, just like the basic. In the non-Abelian gauge theory, I would take this closed path and then also take the trace. Then just like the basic plaquettes for gauge invariant, this guy would be gauge invariant. And I want to compute the expectation value of this object in this discretized lattice path. Okay, that's what I want to do. Is this clear? Okay. So, now let me be a little more specific. Okay, so what do I want to calculate? I want to calculate the expectation value of product of e to the power I phi Li's, where Li's are the links along some closed path that I specify.
So these links are on this Linsner group, or it's inside the Linsner group?
So the links are the links. So let me show you in two dimensions, so it's a general one. I specify some path. Like this rather, for example. Okay? And the statement that I want to compute the expectation value of the Wilson loop is the statement that I want to compute the expectation value of the products of these links along this path. Is this clear? So let's call this 1, 2, 3, 4. I'm just labeling the links up to wherever. And this is product of e to the power I phi. A product of the W's on each of these links in that order. In the Abelian theory, the order doesn't matter. Not Abelian theory. Is this clear what I want to compute? Okay. Now I have to do it. So what I have to do is to do the calculation of this object weighted with d pi x n hat 0 to 2 pi times this exponential. That's this. Okay. Now you see, let me try to think of this thing in Taylor expansion. Just the first time the Taylor expansion is just one. The exponential is just one. What is the answer if I do this integral when I take one? Zero. I get zero because each of these, the integrals of each of the phi's along in one of the links that appears in the Wilson line, just vanishes. Because exponential of e to the power I x from 0 to 2 pi is 0. Now, how could I have that it doesn't vanish? I'm going to have to bring down factors from the path integral. But what are the factors from the path integral? Factors from the path integral are basically plaquettes. Okay? So suppose I was interested in having this guy not vanish. In the integral of this loop and this loop not vanish. I could achieve that by bringing down this limit. But now, I will continue to have that the Wilson loops over these plaquettes These guys, as well as these guys, sorry, the integral over these guys will match. Are you understanding me? I get the inverse phi from this, so that cancels these two, but I've got these integrals will vanish, as well as these will continue to vanish. How do I make it so that the whole thing is not vanishing? Will you see what you have to do is to take
these.
Exactly. You have to take a plaquette. We have to take as many plaquettes as fill out a surface bounded by the Wilson diagram. Okay? So for instance, if we took all the plaquettes drawn on the board, that would fit. If we took this, that would do it. And we chose the guy with the right orientation, so it cancels. You know, we have P and P inverse. We bring down the fellow with the orientation we need. Okay? Because now, for every e to the power 5, there's an e to the power minus. Is this clear? So, what? Is this clear? Okay. What is the weightage that we would get? What? Now, while we have an e to the power 5 and an e to the power minus 5, now the integral is just 1. So, what is the answer then in the strong coupling limit? Okay, so firstly, as more or less an exact statement, what you would have to do is to choose. Now, I've done this in two dimensions, where the only outer surface is basically 4. But let's say we're in three dimensions. We have the surface drawn 3 and 2 dimensions, the lattice was 3 dimensions. We could have had surfaces that came out here. Right? You know, it's like a Lego building, think of it. What this would turn into is into sum over all surfaces that are bounded by our Wilson line. Okay, now with what number will each surface be weighted? Exactly. Number of plaquettes to the power epsilon. So it will be weighted by epsilon to the number of plaquettes.
Suppose I consider this example of a two-dimensional surface.
Yes.
Then the number of basic plaquettes is just 1.
Yes.
Right? So there is no effective sum in the exponential there. Because that's the sum over all basic plaquettes.
No, and plus the sum over all space-time ones.
Apart from the space-time ones.
No, but the space-times are very important. Because you're bringing on this, one space-time, plus this.
But that would give you how many plaquettes you need.
How many plaquettes you need. So and the number of plaquettes you need is the area.
Right. So that's one basic plaquette. And times number of plaquettes, which comes from the sum over all points.
Yeah.
Right?
The number that you need to bring down is the area.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Each time you bring something down, you get down the power of epsilon. Okay? And so, what you will get is epsilon to the power number of plaquettes. Okay? And therefore, you know, we have to work out all the details in more. If we, this can be done with great precision. So this would be epsilon to the number of plaquettes, which would basically be some number to the power area of the surface. Surfaces with greater area than this minimal area thing would be some dominant in this limit. So, this will. So, what we conclude from here is that in this strong coupling expansion, what we find is that the expectation value of this Wilson line goes like e to the power minus some number times the area of this minimal area enclosed by the Wilson. Okay? It doesn't matter. I'm just taking log of epsilon. That's the sum. Okay? said, actually goes through almost without modification for the non-trivial. Because the only thing that we used, the only property of this thing that we used, is the property that if you had 1 e to the power I phi, its integral over all phi's was 0. But it's also true in non-trivial theory that integral du of u is equal to 0. Okay? So that continues to be true. Okay? And then we use that if we had an e to the power I phi and e to the power minus I phi, we no longer go to 0. Okay? Similarly, there is the following statement that du of u alpha beta u u inverse
why is integral du equal to zero?
This is immediately obvious from rotational invariance. Okay? Let us suppose we had integral du of u. Okay? And it was something. This is equal to f. Okay? This is a matrix of us. It's a matrix. Now, let me do a change of variables. Let me do the variable change. U is equal to v times u prime, where v is some fixed unitary matrix. Okay? So, what we will get is that what we will get is that this is dv u prime times times v times u prime. Okay, but the integration measure, when we use the R measure, which is what we are doing to integrate over unitary matrices, the Haar measure has this following beautiful invariance. It's invariant under both left multiplication and right multiplication of group elements by constant group. Okay. So this Jacobian vanishes. This is simply just u prime. So this is also v times. So we just take the v out. Okay? So this f, whatever it is some object that is invariant under left multiplication as well as right multiplication. Now there is no matrix that is invariant under both left and right multiplication of an arbitrary unitary matrix. Just like there's no number that's invariant under left multiplication of a phase and right. There are four matrices that are invariant under left number, left inverse. Identity does that. Okay? Okay, yeah. So that's the reason. Okay, but there are similar statements. If you take du of u times u inverse, then using very similar logic, you can work out the integrals of those quantities. Okay, by demanding group invariance of the thing, you can deduce what this is. Okay. And using the fact that it gives you something non-zero. It's the analog of phase times antiphases. And using that, once again, you basically conclude, I'll leave you to work out the details, or maybe I'll add it to your assignments. So what's happened to the assignments? It wasn't just a new date. Okay, I'll tell you what. We'll give you another week, but I'll add 2-3 problems. This will be one of them. Okay. So we're done with this. Okay, using that, once again, you see the only way to get something non-zero is to fill out these plaquettes. Because every time you have u here, you need a u inverse from the plaquette. And once again, you conclude that you've got an area. Now, the last thing I want to say is the physics of this. The physics of area law is very important. You see, what is the physical interval? So now, we've been talking about that's gone. It's already stopped.
It will loop for 3-4 minutes.
3-4 minutes. So yeah,
famous last words.
So, see, suppose we've got a gauge theory, and we take a Wilson loop like this, one in which we make it a rectangle. One in which we make a rectangle, which is very long, and the width is small compared to this. Okay. So we're going to ignore all the effects associated with this. And we're working in Euclidean space, but now we analytically continue this direction to time. Go back to Lorentzian space. Okay? What is the interpretation of the path integral with the insertion of this Wilson? Okay? In the abelian theory, it's very clear. Same, it's actually similar in the non-abelian. Let me just tell you, and then we can discuss it. You see, the presence of this Wilson loop. Okay? The presence of this. See, what is. Let's first work at the abelian theory. The Wilson loop is just integral e to the power I a dot dx. So it's an addition of a dot dx to the action. Now, when you add something to the action, in any field theory, there's the current operator. The current operator is derivative of the action with respect to A. Okay? So what are you doing? You're adding, in the abelian theory is very clear. You're adding what? A current that is delta function localized. If this is going in the time direction, it's delta function localized. Going in time, so it's just a J0. So it's J0 of something that sits at a point. Okay, but when you come back, because this is this way and this is that way, and that way is minus of that way, you put J0 here and minus of that J0 somewhere else. So, do you see that what you're doing by adding this Wilson loop is working on the path integral in the presence of a charged particle at one point and a negatively charged particle at the opposite point. The analog statement of that in the non-linear theory is that the Wilson loop gives you the path integral of the problem in the presence of a classical quark. By classical, I just mean you're not doing the path integral over the positions of these things. They're just fixed. So presence of an external quark here and an external anti-quark here. Okay? Now, the path integral in the presence of these fields, okay, what's the interpretation of the value of the path integral in the presence of these fields? But the interpretation of the value of a path integral is always vacuum energy times time. This you know, right? Because path integral, Euclidean path integral is e to the power minus beta h. Over very long times you get contributions essentially only over the lowest energy state. So it's e to the power minus beta, which beta is the time direction, times e0. Okay? Now, we're computing the vacuum energy, but then we've got denominators, we're subtracting the vacuum energy of the problem without the Wilson loop. So what this expectation value gives you is the change in the vacuum energy, change in the energy of the problem, the lowest energy of the problem, in the these two cancel with each other. And we conclude the delta E is proportional to length. Okay? Delta E proportional to length tells you that the lowest energy configuration in the presence of a quark and an anti-quark is proportional to the distance between the quark and the anti-quark. This is the statement of confinement. That a fundamental charged object cannot exist by itself at finite energy without having an anti-object somewhere else. If you separate them very far away, you pay an infinite energy price. And moreover, it's a statement of confinement by a very particular mechanism, by a linear potential between the two. Between the two objects. Okay? As we may see as we go along, this linear potential can be thought of as producing some sort of string, a flux tube, which you stretch out more, you see more energy.
Sir,
Sir, is it necessary to think of it in terms of just quarter and your electron? Are you thinking of electron and quarter?
We can. In the UN problem, it's just you electron and quarter. Well, in the non-Newtonian theory, what we've got is something charged in the fundamental.
Okay, so confinement is valid only for the non-Newtonian theory. For example, we don't see confinement or electron and positive.
We don't see confinement for the
electron. So this analysis won't be valid.
You see, all we have done, that's a good question, all we have done is to show that in this strong coupling limit, we get the area law. And now we are interpreting it. So in the strong coupling limit, you're seeing this confinement. Both for the abelian problem, as well as for the non-abelian. There's no difference. Okay? Now the key question is the following. The key question is, to get to the quantum field theory, we need to take this lattice form and take its coupling from being very strong, where there is confinement, to very weak, where, as we have seen, you reproduce the actual dynamics of the continuum theory. Okay. The question is, in this process, is there phase transition? Okay? This object, this area law behavior of the Winsor loop is an order parameter that characterizes phases. Okay? In strong coupling for this lattice model, we have confinement. Question, as you take the transition from to the end wave that we're really interested in, is there a phase transition? Conjecture for non-abelian Engel's theories is no. There's no phase transition. That there continues to be area law dependence, even in the continuum. Okay? This is one statement of confinement of pure gauge. Okay.
But for the U1 theory, you said...
The U1 theory, we know that there is a phase transition. Simulated by the lattice level. Like that. Okay? And when you were weak enough, this is not our last analysis. We'll study these lattice gauge theories a little more in the next class. Okay? One of the things we will do probably in the next class is demonstrate that continuum... the continuum 2 plus 1 dimensional game in this theory undergoes confinement, has area law for the Wilson loop. This is a beautiful proof of confinement of 2 plus 1 dimensional game in this theory by Polyakov. I'll explain that to you. We'll understand these application theories a little more. Okay, they're quite fun. But then we'll soon have to move to continuum. Okay. Let's see, by I'm hoping that by the end of next class we complete our discussion of lattice gauge theories and we discuss BRST symmetry and renormalization of Piangle's area and compute the 1-loop beta function. That will, I'm hoping. Okay. Questions or comments on this?
Yes.
Should
we have had
epsilon
upon number of packets?
Upon number of packets, factor. Yes. Yes. Now, how does that go? Wait. So epsilon to the n by n factorial times P1 plus P2 Pn all to the power n. Okay? Now we have the 1 over n factorial. But we also have the number of ways of choosing P1, P2. So that itself is an n. What? No, I think you will have that because you just have these traces.
Oh, yeah,
it's the same thing.
Yeah.
So, this is just, you know, the number of ways of, you understand, right?
Yeah. Sir, when calculating the number of packets, I didn't think how you get epsilon to the power number of packets. Epsilon was the explanation.
Right. So we have e to the power epsilon times, and we have to bring down as many factors of this object as we need in plugins. It's this thing. See, we have to bring down epsilon to pi by n factorial, then times this p1, that's the epsilon.
If you have even the traces, and then you have a matrix that you outside, it's not going to cancel it.
It's going to cancel because of the intentful aspect functions. Let me explain this. Okay. So suppose, let me take an example. Let me take a Wilson loop, two plugins. With two basic plugins. Okay, so suppose this was a Wilson. Okay. Now, so this is the thing I was planning to give you as your exercise, an indicator works. Okay, so this guy is, let's just get the names, U1, U2, U3, U4, U5, U6, in these directions. And let's call this guy V. Okay, so what do we want to compute? We want to compute trace of U1, U2, U3, U4, U5, U6. Okay? Now, what we bring down is trace of U1, V, U5, U6, but inverse. So U6 inverse, U5 inverse, V inverse, and U1 inverse. And then we bring down another trace of these guys also inverse. Okay. So this will actually be, so this is actually V times U4 inverse, U3 inverse. Okay, and now I want to show you that this this thing integrated over U1, U2, U3, U4, U5, U6, and V is not. Okay? Now, to do that, you need to know what is the integral. Okay. Basically, what this is a product of U's and U inverses, and then various index contractions. So you need to know the basic answer to the problem. What do you get by integrating U times U inverse? U with two matrix indices, U inverse with two matrix indices. Let's quickly try to understand how to figure that out. I'm sure you will do that since we started. So, UMN, U inverse, PQ. Suppose I want to do this. Okay. Now, the basic rule here, so what could we get? If we want something to be left and right independent, there are only two possible structures, right? Delta NP, delta NQ, upper and lower indices at the one time. That's one structure. The other structure is delta M and delta P. So this object has to be equal to A times this plus B times this. Okay, we're normalizing the half measure, so integral of 1 is 1. Okay, so this is this by root invariance, we know that this is true. And now we have to figure out what A and B are. Okay, so let's do this.
The second case is just the fact that they are identity.
Yeah, exactly. The anti-fundamental fundamental in this case. Okay? We'll figure this out in many different ways, but you see, another way of saying it is that we want this to be invariant under, let's figure it out and then we'll check everything works. Okay, so one way of doing this is now take N and P and contract. If I take N and P and contract, then this thing is just delta MQ. So delta MQ du integral of 1 is over du is 1, so this should be just delta n a q. So if I take n and p and contract, so n okay, yeah, n and p and I contract here, I'll get b delta n q. But here I'll get a n delta m q. Okay, so one equation that we get from here is that a n plus b is equal to 1. Okay, then the other thing that we could do is the following. Suppose we contracted each of these with themselves. Okay, so okay, now it depends on whether we're doing the SUN theory or the UN theory. Suppose we're doing the SUN theory for a moment. Contracting these with themselves, this is easy. Okay, so if we contract M with N, we should just get 0. M with N here gives N B plus A is equal to 0. Solve these two equations simultaneously. That gives you A and B. Okay? So you found the value of what this is. Okay, it'll give you something. Plug that in together. You'll get something. You'll do this more systematically, this problem.
So what is
hard
measure?
Hard measure. Given a group manifold. A group manifold is a manifold. Okay, it's labeled by any manifold you can, some coordinates on it. And then there is a useful integration measure for this manifold. Okay, the Haar measure, for any compact group, there exists a measure which is invariant under left and right multiplications of the group. Okay, that measure is called the Haar measure. Let's see. So, let's take very simple examples. Let's take a very simple example. Suppose the group was just an abelian group. Okay? So the group was just the abelian group, the Haar measure is just d theta. Because left multiplication is translation, right multiplication is also translation. Just a translation in the middle. Suppose the group was SU2. In that case, the group manifold is S3. And there, the metric, the Haar measure, is just the measure inherited from the round metric on S3. The metric that you know. The metric you would write for an S3. Okay? That preserves SO4. So in particular, it preserves multiplication from the left by SU2 and multiplication from the right by SU2. That's the SO4.
It's multiplying the measure.
No, multiplying V. Suppose you've got some parameters, okay, that parameterize where you are, some coordinates, okay? Now, you change variables according to a multiplication of the group element. So the basically there's symmetry in this problem, and you want your the measure to respect that symmetry. And the problem point is that you can always do it. Many properties about integration over this symmetric measure can be deduced without actually ever doing an integral, just by using symmetric ability. Okay, very good.